Lord Patten, 50 days before the arrival of Benedict XVI in Britain, is the expectation of British people for this event growing? Which events of the visit require the most effort in organisation?
I think interest is growing and will grow rapidly as people return from their summer holidays. The media are going to be showing the visit wall to wall. After all, this is the first state visit by a Pope to the United Kingdom ever. Not the first visit, because Pope John Paul came on a pastoral visit in 1982, but there will be huge interest in Pope Benedict's visit. And I think the shape of the visit, both the state occasions and the pastoral, will command increasing enthusiasm and interest. So I would expect that to grow as we go through the, is it really only 50 days to go, as we go through that period.
And about the event that require most effort in organization?
I think inevitably the dovetailing the pastoral events with the specifically state events is more difficult than we anticipated, but we're, I think, getting round the problems. If you have a normal head of state coming to Great Britain, say even President Obama, they're not taking part in occasions where there are 80 or 100,000 or more people. So that makes for some complications. But I think the great outdoor masses in Glasgow, at Bellahouston Park, in Birmingham, when we're looking forward to the beatification of Cardinal Newman, I think those will be difficult to manage, but I think they will be hugely successful, provided that we get reasonably good weather. But even with driving rain, I'm sure people would still find the spiritual experience extraordinary.
Yeah. What about the visit of John Paul II in 1982? What memories did this visit live with the general public and with the Catholics in particular?
Well, with this Catholic, the memories are slightly mixed, because I was in hospital. My appendix had blown up and I had a huge abscess which had to be dealt with. So I watched the visit on the hospital television set in my ward. I think generally, when you look at the photographs of the visit, it was a huge success. And I've had many people say, well, I only managed to get a distant glimpse of the Pope on this or that occasion, but I'm still pleased I was there, and that it was an important part of my life and my children's life. So I think for many people who attend these events, who stand in the street to watch the Pope Mobile go past, who witness the Pope's pilgrimage, I think that for those people it will be a very significant personal and family occasion.
To leave some fruits in the life of the Church and the people in?
Well, I hope it will help to animate what is a thriving church community, and I hope it will encourage some people who think that they don't need God in their lives to question that.
The motto of the visit of the Pope will be "Heart speaks unto heart," the motto of Cardinal Newman, who will be beatified by the Pope on September 19. What is the importance of this historical figure in British society today?
Cardinal Newman is one of the great figures of the 19th century in Britain, not only because of his role as a ecumenical figure, as a pastoral figure, great parish priest in Birmingham for many years, not only for his role as an intellectual, but also for the contribution he made to civilizing society. I'm the head of a university, Oxford University, where Cardinal Newman studied and then taught at two of our colleges before being a Anglican priest in Oxford. And Cardinal Newman wrote the best book about the liberal values of education and higher education that anybody's ever written. It's something which is very important for us to remember today, when on the whole it's the utilitarian aspects of university education which people focus on. But Cardinal Newman wrote about the impact on the individual personality of education. He wrote about the civilizing effect that education, stretching people, allowing them to develop their full potential, has on a whole society. I think those are important issues today which we need to remember, lest we descend into meretriciousness and consumerism. He was a great man, Cardinal Newman, and I think that in beatifying him, you know, this is unusual in his own country, indeed, beatifying him within hundreds of meters of where he was laid to rest, the Pope will be signaling a really important part of English, of British history, and commemorating the memory of a man who was a great Englishman, great European, great Christian.
Last question. After the tension between the Labour government and the Catholic Church related to the approval of the Equality Bill and the recent election of the new Prime Minister, how can we now define relation between church and state in your country?
Well, it's important to recognise that they're separate. I've been in politics, I am no longer, I've been a Catholic in politics, have always voted my conscience, and that has sometimes meant that I've voted against governments or opposed what governments are doing, both of the left and the right. I think it's very important when there are issues of morality arising about which the Pope, about which the Church feels strongly, for the Church to make its views very strongly. And it's perfectly reasonable for governments to engage in a debate about them. We don't want, and we don't live in a theocracy. So there's an important, if sometimes tense and stretched relationship between church and state. I think that it's part of our liberal tradition that should be so. Let me give you an example of that. Which doesn't directly relate to the Catholic Church. There's just been a discussion in France and legislation about the wearing of the burqa, trying to ban it. Most of us in Britain, when we consider this question, think that's an intolerable infringement by the state of people's religious views. Similarly, if an Islamicized country, if people were trying to do the reverse, we'd feel very strongly about it. Now, it does sometimes produce arguments, but I think those are the sort of arguments that you're accustomed to in a free society. I don't think that the British government and the Catholic Church see eye to eye on everything. I don't see eye to eye on everything with the British government, I hope that it's possible for us to focus on the biggest issues where we see eye to eye: global equity, education, sustainable environmental issues, sensible disarmament, the role of faith groups like the Catholic Church in promoting social solidarity and a stronger sense of community. Those are the big issues on which we see eye to eye. And occasional disagreements about this or that aspect of legislation should not, in my view, be dominating the agenda. I don't think I have to repeat myself that everything the Church and a conservative liberal government in Britain do will be on all fours. But by and large, I think we're both trying to shape the world in a more civilized way.
Thank you very much.